Sessions and roundtables are being webcast live. I also understand that ESCAP sub-regional offices have organized development seminars and are linked to us by video and Twitter. Welcome to all those who are connected to us virtually. The Secretariat has created a Twitter account to enable those viewing the webcast to tweet their questions to the panelists. The Twitter handle is @UNESCAP. That's @UNESCAP in all capital letters. And the hashtag, and please use the hashtag CS70. The ministerial roundtable will be moderated by the executive secretary herself. The roundtable was scheduled to begin at 10:30 and to go on till 12 p.m. It's almost 12 right now, it's 11:45. So we will not be able to enjoy the 1.5 hours scheduled for the ministerial roundtable, but may I recommend that we use at least 1 hour from our lunch break, so take it till from 11:45 till 1 p.m., giving us 1 hour, 45 minutes, 1 hour, 15 minutes to discuss this very, very important theme. May I now invite Dr. Shamshad Akhtar, the Under Secretary General of the United Nations and the Executive Secretary of ESCAP, to please introduce the topic and the panelists and then moderate the session.
Mr. Prime Minister, it is an honor for me to introduce our distinguished panel of speakers. Given their extensive experience and knowledge about regional cooperation and connectivity, we are fortunate to have this valuable opportunity to benefit from their perspectives. Where are the panelists? On that side. So shouldn't they be here? Okay. I was just trying to check the logistics. I apologize. But I'm going to call on the panelist. First, His Excellency Mr. Lee Thush, Senior Minister, Chairman of the National Committee for ESCAP, and Vice President of the National Committee for Disaster Management, Cambodia. His Excellency graduated with a master's degree in business administration from the University of California and a Bachelor of Public Law from Sorbonne. He has held senior positions with the government of Cambodia, including being a former Minister of Rural Development and Under Secretary of State in the Ministry of Environment. So I suggest as I call upon the panelists, they can come and take their seats so that people know who I have called on. Secondly, let me call His Excellency Mr. Xin Yao, Deputy Minister of Transport of the Government of the Union of Myanmar. His Excellency Mr. Xin Yao graduated from the Defense Service Academy with a Bachelor of Science degree and a Master's degree from Myanmar National Defense College. His Excellency Mr. Yao has been the Deputy Minister for Ministry of Transport for the Republic of the Union of Myanmar since appointment in August 2013 with responsibility for aviation and maritime affairs. Before that, he was the Deputy Minister for Ministry of Foreign Affairs and he has served as an ambassador to Republic of India. I am going at a very fast speed because of Prime Minister's instruction to meet the deadline the time. So let me turn to my third panelist, Honorable Louis Casamber, Under Secretary of Science and Technology Department, Philippines, and Chair of the ESCAP Committee on ICT, also serving as the Executive Director of the ICT office of the department. One of his goals is to make significant contribution to improve the lives of Filipinos through the use of ICT as a catalyst in socioeconomic development. After graduating from the University of the Philippines, with a degree in electrical engineering. He has spent 36 years in the information technology field in both in public and private sectors. Now, I have the honor to introduce Honorable Conley Sadankar Bathu, Minister of Development, Planning and Aid Coordination of the Government of the Solomon Islands. Honorable Sadankar Bathu graduated from the University of Western Sydney in 1996 with a master's degree in agriculture, and he has been he was the Minister of Development Planning and Aid Coordination. The Minister of Development Planning and Aid Coordination since October 2012. Prior to that, he was the Minister of Agriculture and Livestock. I also have the pleasure to invite Mr. Baketa Mohammed Zahamov, who has been a great friend and colleague of ESCAP, and he was also he has been the chair of the Asia Pacific Forum for Sustainable Development. He has been associated with Environment and Water Resources of Kazakhstan. He graduated from Kazakh State University with the scientific degree of biological sciences, and he has had a very distinguished scientific career. He also served as the executive director of the fund of the first president of the Republic of Kazakhstan, director of the Institute of World Economy and Policy under the fund of the first president of the Republic of Kazakhstan. Last but not least, I have the distinct pleasure to invite Mr. Wenshai Zhang, who is the Vice President Operations at the Asian Development Bank. I say that simply because I know him personally also, and I've had a career at ADB, which I have thoroughly enjoyed. He joined ADB in December 2013 and is responsible for operations in South Asia Department and the Central and West Asia Department. Mr. Zhang holds a PhD in finance from the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. He studied international economics in China, and prior to joining ADB, Mr. Zhang was the Director General of the Department of External Economic Cooperation at the Ministry of Finance of China, and we could not do anything without his support when he was holding this portfolio. So thank you for taking the time to come. With these remarks, I think I'm also going to now land in the panelist seat. As pointed out by His Excellency the Prime Minister, I'll take some time to introduce the topic. We have heard quite a bit about regional connectivity in all the different morning presentations, including my policy statement, but also some very useful comments from Their Excellencies Prime Ministers. I think the reason why we chose this topic is quite evident, because it's clearly very important. For one, we have done a theme study, but also it is identified as a very high priority in Asia Pacific. This has become a number one priority and imperative for Asia and the Pacific. Our region, as you know, has a very strong tradition of promoting regional connectivity. It is quite self-evident as we have been able to nurture the Asian Highway and Trans-Asian Railway networks. Asia-Pacific now serves as a role model for regional connectivity in Africa, Latin America, and other regions. And this is largely because of the real results that Asia-Pacific has achieved. And as you may, some of you may already know, the success of this connectivity is evident from the rise in the intra-regional trade in Asia and the Pacific, and it's almost about 7 trillion. There's also a proliferation of the global value chains and the production, regional production networks. A lot of outsourcing and subcontracting takes place in our region, which is clearly lays the basis for highly competitive businesses. Our dynamism and success is, of course, rooted in our ability in Asia-Pacific to look beyond natural jurisdiction, and we are always reaching out for larger potential markets for resource sharing, business expansion, and sustainability. There are a number of good regional examples of geography. There are actually a number of reasons why we see a lot of geographical and political differences in the process of our trying to harness regional connectivity. This is largely because of the sensitivity across borders, but also because the cross-border movement of goods, services, and people is not very well developed in some of the countries. I think to the credit of our member states, the ESCAP intergovernmental platform has on a continuous basis been reflecting on the question on the regional connectivity. Now, what have we been doing in the area of regional connectivity in ESCAP? First, we have developed master plans, legal agreements, and protocol. We have been working hand in hand with governments, multilateral institutions like Asian Development Bank, and now we are also going to be working more with World Bank. And basically, our idea is not only to have platforms like this, but to make sure we are supporting the funding organizations and facilitating them through the legal agreements and clearing the ground and laying foundation for regional connectivity. So I'm very proud to present to you the theme study, which I had handed to the three prime minister, and copies, more copies of this are available. The key thing is that the theme study presents a new reflection for the 21st century regional connectivity framework. The study calls for establishing new corridors and hubs, and it advocates an integrated model of regional connectivity. Going forward, we have to really establish some standards of how we judge the success of regional connectivity. And I would say that moving from just quantity, as I said in my policy statement, we should really look at the level of effectiveness of the regional networks to facilitate flows of goods, services, people, and knowledge. This is the message our study tries to convey. Another message which the study conveys is the need to integrate both physical and non-physical parameters to offer the most cost and time effective multimodal systems to our people. The key message further of this report is that we need to develop integrated transport system, and in the integration process we have to exploit the interdependence and synergies of five specific elements. One is trade and transport network. Second is ICT networks. Third is the energy networks and people-to-people networks. And finally, the promotion of knowledge-based economies. in developing transport networks, the study advocates the need for integrating the multimodal networks to better link our Central Asian landlocked belt with more prosperous coastal regions. And hopefully we'll hear from our colleague at ADB, because we have been supporting this at the ADB also quite a bit, but also to link our island economies through ICT and maritime networks. And we have our Solomon Islands colleague to shed some light on that. Now, to ensure that these transport networks are fully optimized and operationalized, the study emphasizes that we need to link the currently underutilized networks, particularly the railways, and also we need to invest in intermodal facilities such as dry ports in order to foster greater physical linkages between different modes. We also are advocating parallel development of the shippers and truckers industry. On ICT connectivity, we all know that it has potential to drive productivity and efficiency improvements across all sectors of the ones that we have identified, and that it's definitely the more we do it electronically through operative modes of connectivity, and the better it will be, because it will introduce more efficiency. The study also advocates a cohesive meshed regional network of terrestrial optical fiber, which could provide cost-effective broadband access on both an intra-regional and intercontinental basis to link Asia with Europe as well. ESCAP is also working with governments on promoting Asia-Pacific Information Superhighway, which is based on a set of common principles and regulatory frameworks, and it will facilitate cohabitation of ICT and transport infrastructure networks. You all know that there's a lot of work going on in energy connectivity and security. Most of all, the Asian Energy Highway will help us combine different types of energy transmission networks, including pipelines and cross-border power grids. This is an area where we will hopefully benefit from the Energy Committee, which will be set up as soon as feasible, but it is an intergovernmental committee which we have been advised by our member states to set up, so it will take forward this work further. On people-to-people connectivity that I talked about, governments can help their people access the region's vast knowledge resources, as well as foster better understanding about the region's diverse cultures and value system. Now, finally, I think our experience has shown that there are a variety of mechanisms. Some range from formal intergovernmental agreements and international conventions, something which ESCAP and UN traditionally have been handling, to also voluntary commitments by national governments that can be used to advance the region's connectivity agenda at the regional level. So hopefully we'll be working jointly, both at the national level as well as with our agreements and conventions, to promote this integration. Of course, as was pointed out earlier, a lot of our success will depend on strong political commitment and consensus for cross-border transportation systems, but also harmonization of laws and regulations. We clearly have mentioned that sub-regional connectivity will be paramount for us, so we are working closely with ASEAN, SAARC, CARIC, and we will hold more consultations with them in light of the evidence of this theme study to explore how this could be implemented. There is, of course, in order to meet the demands of integrated infrastructure development and regional connectivity, as has been identified by the theme study. There is need clearly of a lot of capital, because infrastructure deficits, as we know, run into trillions in Asia-Pacific region. So this endeavor of regional connectivity would require us to leverage Asia's saving and reserves, and also to look at regional solutions. In that context, I'm very pleased to invite, identify and also to talk about a little the forthcoming initiative of China, which at ESCAP we fully support, which is relating to Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, as well as the recent movements that have been made on BRICS Bank. Given the size of the financing requirements for some of these initiatives, the more institutions that have the capability and capacity and financing to finance regional connectivity or infrastructure at large would be very much welcome. And these institutions, at least particularly the one that is on Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank, we had a very good presentation from our Chinese finance ministry during our sustainable financing session, and we believe very sincere efforts are underway to make this bank a reality. Although multilateral development banks like ADB and the World Bank are there to meet the financing requirements, but I think given the size and scope of financing requirements, additional institutions with the right governance and corporate structure would be a welcome step to promote regional connectivity. So with this overview of the theme study, I may have not done justice to it, given the time constraint. I would now like to draw on the expertise of our panel and would float a set of questions to our distinguished panel. And I would like to request each of the panelists to confine their remarks for 5 minutes. Then we will open the floor for Q&As, and there will be more opportunity to bring in perspectives at your individual level. So my first call is to Mr. Xin Yao. I recall that in recent years, your government has been leading an intensive transformational process. The government's framework for economic and social reform set a vision for the period of 2012-2015 and identified priorities and sectoral strategies for more inclusive growth, including transport, energy, and ICT connectivity. So with this background, it would be useful to hear from you what has been achieved so far in terms of infrastructure connectivity, in particular in transport infrastructure in your country. How has the public consultation and coordination among different ministries and stakeholders helped in the implementation of processes? So over to you, Mr. Yong.
Thank you, Madam Secretary. Good morning, Excellency, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. First of all, I'd like to extend my heartfelt thanks to ESCAP to inviting me as a panelist in this significant event. Regarding to your question, I will do a short brief with some slides. And this is how our country is planning to do right now and near future. And all these projects are related to the regional connectivity and also can reach to the global. Let me start with the maritime sector. We have three special economic zone and port projects. The first one, the Diloa SEZ, that covers the more than 2,300 hectares of lands, and it's only 16 kilometers away from Yangon. Myanmar Japan Diloa Development Company is in charge of development and management of the SEZ. A total of 45 companies from 11 countries have currently applied for permits for nearly 400 hectares of Class A area, which went on sale recently for manufacturing and our prices. The Lua port will be part of the Lua SEZ, and there are 37 land plots for development. Each plot has 15 hectares and a 200 meter water front line and 750 meters in land wide. Two terminals are now in operation, and general cargo terminals, wine and gas terminals, and grain terminals are going to be built, and now some are under construction. Second, SEZ is a Chowpu wine and gas and terminal. Construction of wine and gas terminal was completed in 2013, and now it is in operation. The CBG consortium has developed a master plan, and an expression of interest from local and international developers have been invited to develop a deep sea port, an industrial package, and an integrated residential area. The third one is the Dawel SEZ. The Italian Thai Development Company has started pre-engineering works since 2009, but has suspended due to the lack of financing. Myanmar and Thai government signed a new MOU in 2012 and formed special purpose vehicle and relating committees for successful implementation of the project. The Dawel project will involve a very huge amount of investment, will comprise various types of industries and business activities such as deep sea boat, shipyard, petrochemical complex, oil refinery plant, steel mill, fertilizer plant, power plant, road and rail link to Thailand, and oil and gas pipeline, and so on. This will be connected in GMS country. And for air transport sector, we have three international airport projects too. First one is Yangon International Airport Extension Project. It's starting right now, and it will be upgraded to accept the 6 million passenger per annum by end of the 2015. And second airport project is Mandalay International Airport Project. The Mitsubishi J-Lux Consortium won the tender to upgrade and operate the Mandalay International Airport to be an aviation hub and logistic hub. The runway is designed for Boeing 747 aircraft, and a passenger terminal has a capacity of 3 million passenger per annum. Expected cargo handling capacity is 4,000 tons per year in 2015 and 8,000 tons per year in 2023. The last project is Handauri International Airport Project. It is a new international airport to serve Yangon. It's located 80 kilometers northeast of downtown Yangon and will be a major gateway and regional hub airport in the future. The capacity of the airport will be 12 million passengers per annum in phase one and 30 million passengers per annum in phase two. It will be started in early 2016 and will be finished in 2018. For construction of maintenance and operation of airport, tenders from two companies, Incheon Airport Consortium and Yeonam CABE JGC Consortium, have been received, and selection process is still ongoing, but it will be announced during this month. And for the land transport sector, we have only one, Yangon-Mandalay Railway Project. A feasibility study has just been carried out, and the project will be implemented phase by phase with the assistance of government of Japan. Objective of the project is rehabilitate and modernize rail infrastructure and relevant facility of Yangon-Mandalay Railway, 620 kilometer long, to achieve maximum train running speed of 100 kilometer per hour and travel time from Yangon to Mandalay within the 8 hours. We have a national transport master plan. It has been formulated with the assistance of the government of Japan. It's a long-term vision and a comprehensive forward-looking analysis for Myanmar transport sectors. Regarding to your second question, the consultation for the all the projects. We have done a series of consultation with the people for the Yangon-Mandalay Railway projects and a Mandalay inland port project. Chief officials from local government, stakeholders, experts, local residents attended the public hearing meetings and quarterly discuss on the impact of this project. A joint coordination committee composed of all related ministries and departments was formed for effective cooperation and coordination for the implementation of the project. This is how we are doing right now in our country. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. York. This was a very quick but a very broad-ranging overview of your connectivity program. Given the stage of development Myanmar is, I'd like to congratulate your government for starting work in these areas, and hopefully we will have more dialogue to talk about the integrated regional connectivity conceptually on how this will be taken forward too. So I want to really thank you for your very useful contribution. Let me now turn to Honorable Louis Cassambra. You have been at the forefront of innovative program on ICT expansion in your academic work and in the private sector. The ESCAP theme study has highlighted areas of multi-sectoral cooperation and the benefits of working across sectors to achieve efficiency gains. Specifically, the study makes the point that there is a growing support in the region for the cohabitation of optical fiber along transport and power networks, as I pointed out. So it would be good to hear from you. What are the challenges in implementing this? And how do you see such an approach benefiting countries in the region? And the second question I have is, what role do you see for governments and the private sector in developing an Asia-Pacific information superhighway and in tackling rural-urban digital divides at the national level? So over to you, Mr. Cassambra.
First of all, we wish to convey our gratitude to the UN ESCAP, to its Executive Director, Dr. Shamshad Akhtar, for giving the Philippines the opportunity to share its views and experiences on connectivity as panelists in this roundtable discussion. Whilst the Philippines is not a party to any transborder optic fiber network, we welcome the strong opportunity for a pan-regional terrestrial fiber optic network offering open access, a mesh configuration, and central management constructed along the rights of way of the region's existing transport or energy infrastructure such as highways, railways, or power transmission networks as recommended in the study. In the Philippines, we have utilized the right of way provided by our Metro Rail Transits and Light Rail Transit Systems in Metro Manila to lay down optical fibers for our Integrated Government Philippines project. The said project aims to interconnect all public offices in Metro Manila for easy sharing of information and delivery of common applications among its users. We have not encountered any challenge in implementing the project, considering that these resources are all government-owned. In the implementation of the same undertaking on a cross-border environment, the following challenges must be addressed on a consensus-based manner: regulatory issues, right-of-way ownership, financing, procurement, project management implementation, ownership of the resulting infrastructure, operation and maintenance, revenue sharing. As to the benefits of such approach, we see the following. One, reduced cost of infrastructure buildup, which will also reduce fees and charges to the end users, interconnecting states. Number two, maximizing of existing infrastructure, which will increase the ROI of the given facilities. Three, increased diversity of international telecommunications networks present along the interconnecting states. And four, promote more areas of cooperation among interconnecting states. And five, future-proof the national telecommunications network of participating states. On the roles of government and private sector in developing the Asia-Pacific Information Superhighway, we perceive the following. For governments, crafting and implementation of collaborative policy among states concerning cross-border interconnection issues. Number two, financing, either direct financing or fund facilitation. Number three, with enabler or leader. And four, as a bulk user of the facilities to ensure viability. For the private sector, first is technical expertise. Second is business development financing. And third is infrastructure sharing. For tackling rural-urban digital divides at the national level, the Philippines has been developing and deploying ICTs according to the requirements of its people. Broadband connectivity has been prevalent mostly in urban areas, so government has had to be creative in developing strategies to cover rural and remote areas of our geographically challenged country of more than 7,100 islands. The use of emerging technologies, such as dynamic spectrum allocation, to make available for the use of the underutilized television bands or the TV white spaces is, we believe, an ideal solution to extend broadband and internet services. We have found that establishing a partnership between government, technology providers, telecommunication service providers, broadcasters, and the civil society is a key towards creating an enabling environment to foster the impactful use of ICTs for development. Our TV white space pilot projects have connected schools, communities, hospitals, and local government units, and even saved lives in the aftermath of Typhoon Haiyan. Extending further the benefits of cooperation that may be gained from this exercise, ESCAP is invited to consider taking on the challenge of taking the lead in developing the pan-regional terrestrial fiber optic network for enhancing regional connectivity as recommended. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your succinct remarks, and clearly we will be seeking more of your guidance as we proceed forward in this regional initiative. Let me now turn to my third question and addressed to Mr. Lee Thoch from Cambodia. As you know, regional connectivity report emphasizes the need for promotion of regional public good culture, where national governments also add to regional connectivity, and highlights the need to optimize investments to achieve efficient infrastructure through institutional coordination and regional cooperation. Cambodia, we know, is very actively cooperating with other ASEAN members in the execution of Master Plan on ASEAN connectivity. And you are also working to get the policies grounded in the strong frameworks for ASEAN economic integration in 2015, along with other ASEAN members. So the question is, what has been achieved in ASEAN connectivity from the perspective of economic integration? I know this is a very loaded question. Cambodia is one of the other one of the 10 countries, but we count on your association with ASEAN. The second question, relatedly, is, what can the region learn from the ASEAN experience? And I indeed apologize for two very heavy-duty questions loaded on your shoulders. We were hoping that we could have ASEAN represented here, but we thought no substitute for a hands-on person.
Thank you, Madam. I tried to make those questions lighter. Madam Executive Secretary, distinguished panelists, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, connectivity and economic integration are key and vital for ASEAN states members' economic development and growth and poverty reduction. For the case of Cambodia, my country is small but strategically important country at the heart of the greater Mekong sub-region. GMS. Cambodia is a member of ASEAN, ASEAN Plus 3, East Asia Summit, and several other sub-regional and regional integration frameworks. Its strategic location in and increasingly integrated GMS in ASEAN, and its proximity to China is a major asset. The prospect of an integrated production network and markets expanding from China through GMS countries to the rest of Southeast Asia provide Cambodia with opportunities for trade, growth, prosperity, private sector development, and poverty reduction. We are, like you said, actively participating in every ASEAN economic and financial initiatives, especially initiatives to realize ASEAN economic community in 2015. On this basis, Cambodia has fully integrated herself into the region and the world and play an active role in international cooperation. Thanks to connectivity and economic integration, Cambodia has been able to achieve fast, solid economic growth with average 7.5% per annum. And power reduction has tremendously improved from 47% in the past decades now to below 20% of poverty. Madam Executive Secretary, as for Cambodia connectivity in ASEAN, we are currently rehabilitating and modernizing our railway system, linking Phnom Penh, our capital city, to its borders with Thailand and Vietnam. Along with such hard infrastructure, progress is being made in strengthening soft infrastructure, the regulatory reform and capacity for capacity building of our government agencies responsible for the smooth and transparent, cost-effective movement of goods and people across borders. Regional connectivity will offer, of course, its best results if it enhances the level and effectiveness of regional networks to facilitate, as you have said, flows of goods, services, people, and knowledge. What can we learn from ASEAN experience? The region may learn from the ASEAN experience, for which the overriding goal will be to further build bridges and break down barriers between member states towards greater intra-regional cooperation and to provide stronger links with external partners. In intra-ASEAN trade investment mobility, it is often said that one of the foundations of economic development is the elimination of geographical distance and times between services, processes, and production markets. Regional interconnectivity is primarily about reducing distance and time, both within ASEAN and between ASEAN member states, global markets, by upgrading communications, transportation infrastructure, and breaking down institutional and policy constraints to increase socioeconomic interaction. To conclude, a strong ASEAN provides member states with an effective platform from which to engage with ASEAN markets and beyond. Indeed, there have already been a number of agreements that facilitate increased economic interaction between member countries and other strategically important economies throughout the world. Interconnectivity and economic integration are key for our region growth. Thank you.
Thank you very much for those insights on ASEAN, which is clearly one of the more advanced regional blocks in promoting regional connectivity and will serve as a benchmark for the other regional blocks that I had talked about this morning, that we need to nurture connectivity there. So with this, let me move on to Honorable Conley Sadang. Kabatu. I hope I'm pronouncing your name right. Clearly, nowhere is connectivity more pressing than in Pacific Island developing countries. Mm. And there will be much debate during the SIDS International Conference on, hopefully, this subject. But I understand ICT connectivity is somewhat a new area, as well as we recognize the tremendous amount of benefits it has in terms of setting tradition of innovation across the key sectors of the economy in Solomon Island and Pacific at large. It would be good to hear from you first as to how much has it been exploited, ICT has been exploited in the region and in Solomon Islands, depending on where you could lay emphasis on, but also how it has enabled better regional access and also access to services in Solomon Islands itself. So over to you.
Thank you, Madam Chair. And also, having the floor, I'd like to take this moment also to acknowledge the presence of our ministers, prime ministers here present, and all other delegates here present at this a very important assembly. First of all, may I put you a little into context about what our countries in the Pacific are like. We are quite divided by water, and small islands more or less dotted throughout each country and so on, and a remoteness from the main centers has been our most difficult challenges. And the question in point basically is ICT. How ICT has created new opportunities for the Pacific Island developing states, in which it creates opportunities for access to link on that helps to enable more access in terms of education, in terms of finance, and also in terms of knowledge sharing, generating, and so on. It is a new innovation that is coming to our shores, and it is holding fast. Please allow me to reflect a little on the experience we have in the Solomon Islands. Basically, in education, it cannot be denied that without ICT, a lot of our students aspiring to go on to tertiary education would not have the chance to do so. We are part of this University of South Pacific in Fiji, and they have what is called a distance education mode, which allows for 12 countries that also affiliate into this University of South Pacific, all have local learning centers out of campus, for which more and more of our students are also affiliating into. Also, too, in the area of phone banking, it is a new innovation coming to our shores, which allows for more and more people, especially those who have no opportunities to bank at all or come within the financial sector at all, out in the remote areas. They are now able to also connect to the IT or mobile banking opportunities. In so doing, we also have this opportunity of not having to walk or not having to travel to an area where you look for information and so on. The marvel of non-travel opportunities. Wherever you are in each of these countries, you have the opportunity to connect. You have the opportunity to search for information, to generate information, and be able to share with others, either within the same country or out of their country as well. So these are opportunities that is now opening to us in the Pacific. And though not all of us, not all of the countries in the Pacific enjoy the privilege of optic fiber cables, that is slowly in the process for some. But the internet service really is making a difference. Thank you, Madam Chair.
Thank you for your succinct remarks. Clearly a beginning has been made, and there's a lot of work to be done in Pacific Islands. Also try to see if one can link it up with the Asia Pacific Information Superhighway, and we look forward to more consultation with Pacific Island economies in this area. So let me turn to Minister Bakhtas Mohammad Zanov. You have been affiliated quite a bit with ESCAP, and you know the imperatives of the sustainable development quite deeply. You've gone through the theme study. As you know, it's emphasized the need for multi-sectoral collaboration sustainable approaches to connectivity. We clearly would benefit by hearing from you more about the great advances that are being made by Kazakhstan on not only how you see what the theme study is recommending and how Kazakhstan is positioning its regional connectivity strategy, but also run us through a little bit on your country's vision and mission to have more Central Asian connectivity, because during my visit to Kazakhstan, it was underscored that that is very critical. And of course, we have SPECA also that Kazakhstan has been supporting too. So with these observations, I would appreciate your comments.
Большое спасибо, Ваше Превосходительство, дамы и господа, уважаемые участники сессии. Прежде всего, я хотел бы поблагодарить уважаемую исполнительную секретаря ЭСКАТа за приглашение принять участие в данной сессии панели и выступить. Казахстан находится в самом центре евразийского континента и по территории является 9-й страной в мире. И, конечно, мы очень активно развиваем как внутри республиканской сети, так и устанавливаем очень тесные отношения и возможности транспортного обмена с нашими соседями. На сегодняшний день ведется активно строительство автомобильной дороги Западный Казахстан, Западная Европа. И в 2015 году эта дорога будет закончена. Это более 3000 километров современной автодороги, которая позволит очень быстро доставлять товары из Западного Китая, с границы Западного Китая до Западной Европы. Также запущена работает система контейнерных перевозок, железнодорожных перевозок, которая также позволяет быстро перевозить товары из Китая в Россию и дальше в Западную Европу. Кроме того, активно развивается и авиационный транспорт. На сегодняшний день Казахстан связан практически со всеми мировыми центрами. У нас создана единая система управления всеми аэропортами. И сейчас проводится большая модернизация системы метеорологического обеспечения безопасности полетов. И мы надеемся, что в ближайшие 2 года мы эту всю систему запустим, и это позволит нам еще более тесно налаживать авиасообщение. Кроме того, мы активно развиваем морской порт, порт Актау, который позволяет нам выходить на порты, перевозить грузы в Азербайджан, в Иран, в Россию. И мы надеемся, что сейчас для того, чтобы обеспечить сохранность биологического разнообразия Каспийского моря, вообще уникальность Каспийского моря, все страны подписали, приняли единую Тегеранскую конвенцию, которая подразумевает защиту биоразнообразия Каспийского моря, предупреждение от разливов в случае каких-то аварийных ситуаций на нефтяных месторождениях. Активно развивается и газотранспортная система, нефтетрубопроводная система. Через территорию Казахстана проходит газопровод, который идет из Туркменистана в Китай, из Казахстана в Китай. И мы надеемся в следующем году закончить большой проект, связанный и с газификацией нашей столицы Центральной Азии, которая также проводится большой газопровод из Западного Казахстана в центр Казахстана. И мы надеемся, что в ближайшее время будет закончена и другая большая транспортная сеть, это железнодорожная сеть Казахстан, Туркменистан, Иран и выход на морские порты Ирана. Участок железной дороги между Казахстаном и Туркменистаном уже закончен, и мы надеемся, что в ближайшее время участок между Туркменистаном и Ираном также будет закончен, и мы сможем открыть это сообщение. Проводится большая работа по реконструкции автомобильных дорог, связывающих Казахстан с Узбекистаном, связывающих Казахстан с Кыргызстаном. Мы надеемся также, что вхождение Казахстана в таможенный союз Казахстана и России позволит нам значительно удешевить перевозку товаров через территорию России в связи с тем, что у нас будут установлены единые тарифы на железнодорожные перевозки. Также будут сняты барьеры, таможенные барьеры на границе между Казахстаном и Россией, что позволит значительно быстрее провозить грузы через территорию Казахстана, России и Западного Китая в Западную Европу. Ну и, конечно, здесь активное развитие транспорта создает определенные проблемы у нас и с сохранением экологии. В частности, автомобильная дорога Западный Казахстан, Западная Европа, газопровод, оно пересекает пути миграции традиционных наших животных. Такое есть поголовье сайгаков, это древняя популяция антилоп. И сейчас оно находилось на грани вымирания, но приняты меры позволили нам 10 раз увеличить поголовье. И, к сожалению, вот эти вновь построенные транспортные коридоры не всегда учитывали потребности пути миграции. И вот эти проблемы нам надо решать, и мы надеемся, что активное развитие всех видов транспорта не нанесет вреда экологии и позволит нам гармонично развивать наши взаимоотношения с нашими со всеми соседями. То есть в Казахстане принята очень большая программа по созданию такого большого транспортного логистического центра через территорию Казахстана, который значительно позволит ускорить доставку товаров между Западным Китаем, так и Западной Европой. Спасибо.
Thank you for a very broad overview of Kazakhstan's not only just multi-pronged approach in trying to reach different borders more effectively, but also in talking about the overall forward-looking Kazakhstan development strategy, because indeed you are moving to pushing Kazakhstan to a developed country status, and there is tremendous amount of work underway in Kazakhstan. So with this, I will now turn to our last panelist, at least in this first round of initial invite of comments. I'd like to focus more with you, Mr. Zhang, on the important issue of financing. As you know, it's a very important means of implementation for regional connectivity agenda. You've had a very distinguished career being with multilateral initiatives in your work at the Ministry of Finance of China. But now you are also overseeing a very large portfolio of South Asia and Central and West Asia at the Asian Development Bank. And I know when I was there, a lot of seeds had been sown for Mekong connectivity, for South Asia, and also Central Asian, Central and West Asia republics. So it would be good to hear of some of that. But also, my more specific question is, what are the challenges and opportunities that you found in implementing regional programs, especially those involving regional connectivity with some integrated approaches to the, to them, or multimodal elements involved, if at all your projects were, because sometimes we have standalone road projects or standalone other types of energy projects of connectivity, but integrated approaches, if at all, Asian Development Bank is reflecting on. And also it would be good to hear of Asian Development Bank initiatives to catalyze more infrastructure financing, because I know you're gearing the institution to strengthen its infrastructure financing support to member countries. So over to you, Mr. Zhang.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. First, let me thank you and the ESCAP to invite me to be here on behalf of the Asian Development Bank to share views with our distinguished Prime Minister, Honorable Prime Minister, Ministers, and distinguished guests from the ESCAP member countries. And I think you choose a very important topics, and but given the time limit, I will try to be very brief. I think, first, let me congratulate you on a very good study. And I think we share many things from your study findings. So I think good for us, for the ADB also, to try to learn from ESCAP, you know, how we further increase the regional connectivity. And on the issue you raised about the opportunity, the challenges, I see that in our region, that certainly, like you said earlier this morning, if we want to really increase the regional connectivity, we do need the political and commitment. I see that among the member countries, we have that, you know, increasingly we have seen that kind of commitment and kind of, you know, the mutual trust among the member countries. So that's really the most fundamental basis for us to move forward. And also, I see that you know, this region is more and more integrated. And you see from the data of intra-regional trade investment that's growing, you know, over the years. I can see this is a momentum for that will continue in the coming years. And so I think that with the more integrated economy in the regions, the member countries certainly will need more kind of, you know, regional cooperation and integration. So I think, as you also mentioned, that in the coming years, we'll see more and more country moving to the middle-income countries in the region in the next maybe 5, 10, or 15 years. So that with that kind of increase of the income, so countries are concerned will have more capacity to, right, to do this kind of, you know, regional cooperation program. And also we see that as we move forward, there are more and more these kind of regional products, public goods we need to generate to deal with the common challenges in terms of climate change, in terms of natural disasters, you know, energy security related issues, you know, and communicable disease, these kind of things, right? We do need to work together. No country can do it alone, right? So with that common challenges, so I feel that we certainly there's a need for the member country to work together. I think that's just the opportunities there. It's a great opportunity for us. For the challenges, I could see that certainly we need to further strengthen our you know, that member communication dialogue among the member countries. We see that you know, we need to further strengthen that dialogue. We had that you know, political will, but we still need a more even closer dialogue among the member countries. And I think we do need further strengthen, as your study also pointed out, you know, more stronger institutional coordinations. We have very good, you know, some mechanisms there. We have the ASEAN, we ask, you know, 10+3, APEC, and CARI, GMS, you know, SAC, SASEC, many, BIM, STAC, you know, I just, you know, many regional, sub-regional kind of mechanisms there, so that with that, I think we should further strengthen, you know, that coordination by using this kind of, you know, existing one. And so with that, we can further, you know, to dealing with the challenges for closer dialogue and coordination. And also, I think you mentioned also that challenging we face is how we transfer that the physical part of our connectivity into the economic corridor, what we call, how we transfer the transport corridor into the economic corridor. This is something, you know, really the big challenges. We build a road, we build a railway, ports, waterways, but how, and you know, that build the transmission line, but how can we let the people along that, you know, corridor to benefit from that, to have more job creation, to have more trade, more investment, more movement of goods and services, right, along that corridor. So let people to benefit, to make our project more inclusive. So this is something, you know, that is a big issue in front of all of us, I think. So this is also, I think, is a big challenge for us. Another one in my mind is that, like you mentioned, that the financing, you know, given the huge, you know, the challenges, right, in the infrastructure deficit and also the huge demand for the financing in this sector. So I still that feel that this is a big challenge for us. How can we mobilize more money, right? We have still have limited financial resources from the MBB, and from the, you know, public sector, but how can we get more money from private sector? How can we get more money from the new banks, new developed bank, right? You mentioned about this AIB or BRICS bank, and together with others, how can we make all this together, right? Together with the, you know, partnership from private sector, from civil society and others. So this is also, nobody can do it alone, I think, because of huge demands. So we are, you know, ADB talking about this, even the second generation of regional cooperation from the, you know, country level, you know, that connectivity project, you know, transport, energy, and, you know, trade facilitations. And we are talking about even further beyond that. How can we, you know, even build the connectivity between not just within the sub-region, but also across the sub-region, like South Asia and Southeast Asia, and even beyond the Southeast Asia to the East Asia. How can we build that linkage between South Asia and the Central and Western Asia, right? So a lot of corridors kind of project concept here. How can we turn that into a reality? So it's something, you know, we do need to work together. So I think this is something, you know, really are in front of us, and you know, how can we, you know, that to address these kind of challenges? I do think we there's a lot of work to do for us, and so I think you know, I said for the second generation in regional cooperation, we even talk about how we address, you know, the skill needs of the corporations, knowledge sharing, capacity buildings, you know, this kind of things, right? So I see between, you know, beyond the original kind of investment project, how can we share knowledge, how can we do the capacity buildings, so a lot of things we should do. Even now we are talking about how can we promote even the cross-border economic corridor. So many countries in the region I know, I visit, they talk about the economic corridor, economic zone, special economic zone. Our colleagues mentioned about that, industrial economic zone, right? How can we really even do further, do this kind of cross-border economic zone? So that also will really need more financial resources and more kind of, you know, efforts from the stakeholders. So, Madam Chair, those are the things I just see, you know, great opportunities, but also many tremendous challenges we are facing. But certainly, I feel that we can, if we can work together, we can make a difference. So I still believe, right, regional corporate integration is very important. And if we really want to achieve the sustainable growth, inclusive growth in this region, we must do the more regional corporate integration, so that so we can have a shared, really kind of shared prosperity at the end. So that's why I will stop here. I will come back second round. Thank you.
Well, thank you to all the panelists for bringing in the very interesting perspectives in the first round of the questions that I have posed. Now I'm going to open the floor for questions, and I'd like to. I think the topic is definitely a very exciting one, and there's a lot, as has been pointed out, that the region has done. So it would be great to hear from different member states about what their initiatives have been and where you see the scope for us, Asian Development Bank and ESCAP, to work more closely with you. So with these, can I see some show of hands? Okay, Prime Minister, come back to you.
Thank you very much. I was trying to understand what the representative from Asian Development was talking. Don't be angry with me, but you talk too much about corridors. The important corridor that I see in Asian Pacific is how can we develop an integrated plan, and how can ADB provide assistance in a more equitable way? Because you just look at ASEAN countries. ASEAN countries, we have many levels of development. How can we, from ASEAN countries, we reduce the inequality between neighbors by taking advantage of a help from ADB? Just say, I was in Indochina. I went to Cambodia, I went to Laos, I went to Myanmar, and we see that there is something that what we need to try a corridor of reducing the inequality amongst countries in ASEAN countries, I'm only talking about ASEAN countries, is how the plan, integrated plan, can be presented and how ADB can help reducing this inequality. And how you see each country, because sometimes we talk too much about big roads, big infrastructures, but what is the basis of the economy? I try to follow the problem, the crisis in Europe, and the developed countries in Europe, with all of these crises, they put emphasis on small and medium enterprise. How can we coordinate? How can we have a common sense of what can we do? We in my country, now, the big problem of for us is how can we start the small and medium enterprise and agro-industry initiatives to reduce the import, because if we don't reduce the import, we will be very dependent. That is why it is, yes, the corridors, we work together, but can you, as a financial institution, can you give us a kind of better, more clear perception of how can you help? Thank you.
Thank you. I think I'm going to pool questions, Your Excellency, if you allow me, before I can get the panelists to respond. So let me now turn to, I have a list of delegates who'd like to pose questions to the panel, and I'm speaking, I'm going to call in order of how I saw the flags. China.
Thank you, Madam Executive Secretary. Connectivity seems to be a catchword of the day, but I believe for ESCAP it is not something new. Since its inception in 1947, it has made tremendous efforts in assisting member countries in their post-war reconstruction, infrastructure in particular. We all know the Asian highway network, trans-Asian railway, multimodal transport linkages, to name just a few. and we all benefited in one way or the other from these regional transport cooperation initiatives enhancing connectivity in our region. So in that regard, I would like to pay tribute to what ESCAP has done. And in today's world, I believe this organization still has a promising future, a prominent role to play in that regard. And I believe it is also fitting for the commission session to choose this subject as the theme. And against the uncertain backdrop of the world economy, our region still is the most promising ones in terms of economic vitality and growth potential. However, we lag far behind the developed world with regard of connectivity, just as some of the panelists have indicated. And for that reason, there should be a strong political consensus that strengthening connectivity could create jobs, create wealth, alleviate poverty, and serve as a new engine for growth, even though there has been some talks about the backdrop of connectivity, like it may also bring strange ideas, extremist elements, organized crimes, drugs, but still, there should be a strong political consensus that it is good for the economy, good for the society. That is my first point. Second point, by strengthening connectivity in our region, we should bear in mind the following four important elements. First, openness. We should have an open mentality. We should be open to our neighbors and beyond, and promote free flow of goods and services, and get rid of the protectionist mentality and measures. Second, mutual benefit. We should make sure that everybody is a stakeholder and also come out as a winner. Only in this way, our efforts in the region could sustain and flourish. Third, comprehensiveness. We should not only strengthen our efforts on the physical connectivity, but also institutional connectivity and people-to-people connectivity. So it should be a comprehensive connectivity. The last point is we should be interactive. The whole process should be an interactive process that may involve not only the government, but also the private sectors, academics, and we should have a regular exchange of views on the subject in order to have innovations to promote connectivity. And I believe roundtable like this one is a good attempt in that regard. And I strongly believe by involving the private sector and the academics is also very important. Thirdly, a brief word on our national efforts. We learned from our own experience the benefits of enhancing connectivity. And for the moment, China is still the largest construction site in the world. The high-speed trains under construction equals the total length of trains of the whole world. Even though we have accomplished much, but still there's a long way to go. And region-wide, we've also put forward three specific initiatives, namely the Silk Road Economic Belt, the Maritime Silk Road, and also the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. These are the three specific initiatives come from China. We hope that the members and social members of this organization could actively participate in those initiatives. And we believe all efforts in those initiatives will be a step by step once, and it should be a voluntary process, and all the partners should be equal. And lastly, a few words on the Asia Infrastructure Investment Bank. We have already, the initiative has actually been raised last autumn by our leaders during their visit to the Southeast Asian countries. And since then, several rounds of multilateral and bilateral consultations have been held on this initiative. And we are aiming for the signing of a memorandum for this bank in the next autumn. And for the moment, the negotiations and consultations is moving steadily. And what I can inform our colleagues today is that for the moment, we have already had dozens of commitments from the countries in the region to be the founding members of this bank. And I hope more countries will join the bank later. And even though it looks promising for the bank, but please do not have too high expectation for its role. Based on what our colleagues from the Asian Development Bank, there's a huge infrastructure deficit. According to statistics, this region, the Asian developing countries, in the next 10 years will need at least $8 trillion for infrastructure investment. And by 2030, the world will need $55 trillion. While for our bank, the Asian Investment Infrastructure Investment Bank, it's just about 10 or 100 billion US dollars size. So for that matter, it's just a small drop of water in the vast sea. And we hope that all of us can contribute in the financing for the infrastructure in such a way. Thank you.
Sorry.
Thank you.
What about BRICS?
I'm going to call on delegate from Tuvalu.
Thank you, Madam Chair, moderator. I thank the panelists for the stories told, which is quite, they are all very informative and a bit scary and interesting, challenging, and constructive. Tuvalu is a very small island state, LDC member, with only 26 square kilometers and a population of 11,000 people. Anyway, the theme is very interesting, connectivity. One cannot deny the fact that connectivity is technology related. And technology, of course, is major ingredient in all facets of development, be it economic, social, or cultural. But for small island states like Tuvalu, technology comes with a very high price tag. Let me give you an example before I ask two questions. Transport by air to Tuvalu is out of Fiji, the Republic of the Fiji Islands. And the distance covered is about 700 miles. The return air ticket is about 1,400 Australian dollars. On the internet, I'm just giving two examples. On the internet connectivity, I think it's the highest as well in the world. But not only connectivity with the price tags, the unreliability. So my two questions, I thank my you panelists been talking most on the optic fiber connection. My question is, how much is that if we are to connect to that, and who can help us connect to that network? Because I believe it is, it may be costly at the initial capital outlay, but in the long run, it might be cheaper and more reliable. So maybe that's the question. And my other question is there an FOC technology for connectivity? I mean, free of charge technology for connectivity. I thank the China distinguished representative for sort of indicating their interest to help. So I believe Tuvalu can be the first one to submit the proposal for that assistance. So those are my two questions, and thank you very much, Madam Chair.
I'm going to take other delegates, but may I just request for a short statement or questions, because we are already, we have passed the time allocated for this panel, and I deeply regret that, because unfortunately this panel did require more time for deliberations, but we are learning from this. So let me call on Bangladesh delegate. Then I will call on Iran and India, and then open it to the panelists to respond briefly.
Thank you, madam, and thanks to the distinguished panel for a very lively discussion on a matter of very urgent interest to us in this region. But first of all, let me also record my appreciation for a beautiful study that has been done by ESCAP on this very important issue. We have had a quick look, and multifaceted aspects of the situation have been brought up here. I would need much time, much more than you would give me to discuss all these issues, but two aspects I would like to highlight here and seek panel's comments on these. Not really questions and answers, just comments. Number one, this idea of connectivity of the various aspects, two that come to my mind immediately, which can be addressed, which can be shared among us. Number one is that apart from the physical road connectivity, there is another urgent connectivity that we need is energy connectivity. Power, we are short of power in many countries, like in my country. We are starving for power. There are pockets where in our region where there is more power, there are pockets where there is less power. So if we could sort of sit down and find out through ESCAP's help how we can help each other and of course share the cost, that is one way I think we can raise the living standards for all and gain in terms of productivity or whatever. That's number one. Second, and that is with a bit of trepidation I'm bringing this idea. People to people, this is what you have also brought here. Now, this is a very important subject. It raises a lot of eyebrows, fears. I'm being very frank, because I have been with this issue for some time. I worked in Geneva many years before, while in Akhtar and WTO, and you know, this people movement came up for discussion. Earlier, the fortress mentality that we saw up north in the West, it seems now is transferring to this region also. in my own lifetime, I have seen visa regimes being changed and made harder and harder within our region. That I don't know if others would agree. Even in my own lifetime, in the last 10, 15 years, I have seen that we are finding it more difficult to travel between our countries than in the past. That, I think, is wasteful and contradictory to what you are saying here in terms of sharing and connecting and living together. These things don't go. And it's uneconomic. And I'm sure there's a lot to be gained in terms of value addition if we could address this visa movement issue. I'm not saying visa as such, but movement of people. I really appreciate the distinguished delegation from China when he said about political consensus. That's a very important point here. If we could reach a political consensus and find ways of easing travel by business people, by professionals initially, these sort of things, probably we could make a long, long, long headway. But I'm sorry to say this, I'm sorry to record here that signals on the ground are quite opposite to what I'm saying. And I would like to hear from the distinguished panelist or from anyone else here in this house that how in our region we're going to address this very burning issue, because I feel it's going to be very, 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 very urgent in the next few years. Last but not the least, in terms of our hunger for credit, money, cash, for very large infrastructure and social work that we have to do in our countries. So long, countries like mine, we have been depending on intergovernmental institutions like the World Bank and ADB, and we're happy with that. We have no complaints on that. I'm not trying to say that it's not a good job. But there's clearly need for more here, and we are grateful that two things have recently come up which have raised a lot of excitement. One is the big thing, and the other is, of course, our friends from China, and they share both. They are in both places. Being a very large economy in the BRIC also, they are the heavyweight. In the Asian Infrastructure Bank that they are trying to pilot, they are the heavyweight. So we are waiting, and we are going to see how these two things are going to affect our lives, our economies. Are they going to supplant or supplement the existing system that we have been living on, like ADB, IDB, and World Bank? We would ideally like that they sort of complement each other and assist in particular niche area for each. But it's a very uncertain future, and we would like to hear particularly from the panelists from the China or from anyone here, that whether we are going to face a more comfortable and less Cold War-like situation here, rather more business-like, more economy-friendly, more development-friendly in the coming few years.
Thank you.
Ma'am, thank you for your patience.
May I just inform all the delegates that the translation has ceased because we have exceeded the time. So we would have to... have short statement because also lunch is ready to serve. And in English, please, Iran.
Thank you very much, Madam Executive Secretary. I would also like to thank the distinguished panelists for a thoughtful presentation. My country is well known for its connectivity as a transit country through various transport corridors and rail connectivity for landlocked countries in the Central Asia, South and West Asia. We have extended our rail and road links to neighboring countries. The government of the Islamic Republic of Iran has planned to increase the capacity for transit transport to the volume of 50 million tons per year within its five-year plan. My country also strives to establish and expand energy connectivity through connecting electricity grid lines and oil and gas pipelines to neighboring countries as well. We believe that ESCAP is well placed to be the bridge and to continue to help us to establish necessary arrangements and institutions for the task of enhancing and expanding connectivity. The question to the distinguished panelists is how regional cooperation can be strengthened to build stronger and better connectivity within the region. Thank you.
for your succinct statement. Over to India.
Thank you, Madam Executive Secretary, for giving me the floor. I wish to take the opportunity to begin by felicitating His Excellency Mr. Shering Tobgay, the Prime Minister of Bhutan, for having assumed the chairmanship of the 70th session of the Commission. We have no doubt that under his able stewardship and guidance, the Commission will more than achieve the tasks before it. I also want to thank our panel of ministers for their very valuable inputs, which will go into our consideration of the issue of connectivity. We acknowledge gratefully ESCAP's decision to choose regional connectivity for shared prosperity as its theme for this Commission's deliberations, for this session's deliberations. We believe this is both appropriate and timely. With the onset of rapid globalization, connectivity issues have attained a growing importance for promoting prosperity, but clearly there are several areas within our region where connectivity can be further promoted, and the potentials for increasing connectivity exists. I wish to highlight that the newly elected government in India is deeply committed to promoting regional connectivity and cooperation. It proposes to actively continue its efforts to rebuild connectivity with countries in its neighborhood and beyond. In this context, my government has been working with Myanmar and Thailand in establishing the trilateral highway connecting India to Thailand through Myanmar. ASEAN and India are also in preliminary discussions about possible route alignments for the extension of the trilateral highway to Cambodia, Vietnam, and Laos. The India-ASEAN Joint Working Group on Maritime Connectivity is working on possible maritime links between India, Myanmar, Thailand, Cambodia, and Vietnam. India is also part of the Asian Highway and Trans-Asian Railway Network. It is engaged with Sri Lanka and Maldives in strengthening maritime connectivity, and with Bangladesh, Nepal, and Bhutan in developing rail, road, and multimodal connectivity. We're also part of the BCIM, the Bangladesh, China, India, Myanmar group, which is in the process of planning to create economic corridors between our countries. These initiatives not only bring the countries physically closer through infrastructure, but also build interlinkages that cement friendships, promote joint prosperity, and enable mutually reinforcing support in times of need, such as in dealing with natural calamities. And in the course of discussions, I think a few points have emerged, which I want to highlight. One, of course, is that connectivity does not just mean road connectivity or rail connectivity. Clearly, connectivity also means inter-grid power connectivity. It includes connectivity through fiber optic networks involving ICT. It also includes petroleum pipelines. It includes, as someone has pointed out, people-to-people contacts, and these are all parts, important parts of connectivity. I think the issues of financing of connectivity efforts, the norms that are involved, best practices that are there, lessons learned, are all extremely important, and clearly ESCAP has a very important role in steering the discussions towards regional connectivity efforts in the right direction. India would be happy to continue to support the initiatives of ESCAP for regional connectivity in the Asia-Pacific region. Thank you, Madam Secretary.
Thank you very much. And all I heard was ESCAP will be supported in regional connectivity. So I'm very pleased to hear that. And now I'd like to turn to my panelists and remind them of the very short time we have left. I have only been told that we have 5 minutes. I don't think we can do justice to this, but there will be more country delegate discussions that will follow, and maybe some of this can be taken up in debates. So I will start from Asian Development Bank Vice President Mr. Zhang, because you were the last two panelists. You will be the first one to respond, possibly to all questions.
Yes, thank you, Madam Chair. I'm trying to keep the time. Let me quickly to respond to His Excellency Prime Minister's question about how we support the country's program. Actually, ADB, you know, we started, the country program is our basis for our doing the regional program. We do the country program first. Then we, at the same time, we try to promote the regional program. So country program, you know, I mentioned about the regional integration is one of the strategy agenda, but also ADB. For ADB, we also have other agenda, poverty reduction for the countries, and also for inclusive growth and environmental sustainable growth. So we also have a lot of programs in the countries, in member countries, like in the infrastructures, you know, energy, transport, water sectors, water supply, sanitation, education, finance, and health, agriculture sectors. So many programs in the country. It depends on each country's case. I just want to say that if we really want to promote regional countries, certainly the country, we should help the country first, right? To build the domestic connectivity first. If they don't have the domestic connectivities, certainly that they will not be in a position to go further for the regional connectivity. So that's the basis. I can assure you, Excellency, ADB certainly had a plan, had a country system strategy for our member countries. So we have our annual operational plan. So we will have a plan for support to your country and other even other island countries also. So I just want to assure you that we are not just talking about regional program. We also have many country programs. Second, about the RCI, regional corporate integration. I think for the futures, how we further promote, I think we do need a good planning. We do need a better institutional coordination. We do need a medium long-term planning, because we cannot do it within a very few a short period of time. That would take a long time. So it's not just 1-2 years. So we do need more resources. We do need to mobilize more resources by different partners, not just the existing one, but some others, new banks and private sector, as colleagues mentioned already. So I think this is something that we do need also not only build the physical infrastructure, but also soft infrastructure, like regulatory reform, investment climate change, investment climate improvement, how we reduce tariff barrier or non-tariff barrier, those kind of things, how to simplify the custom procedure, a lot of things we should do, right? So, and also we also need to strengthen capacity building. I mentioned that we needed to strengthen monetary and the financial cooperation. ADB has supported a lot for the ASEAN plus three decades. So I think this financial monetary cooperation is also very important. So I given time, I don't have a chance to talk about all those things we should do. And also we are still facing some capital constraint, but we try to mobilize more money. We are trying to combine our own ADF money with our OCR money. ADF is our soft window. OCR is our ordinary resources window. So we are trying to through this combining to get more equity to support more lending with the bank. We also try to get more co-financing with other private sectors, other MDBs. So that we can get more lending for projects for the countries concerned. So we also want to work more private sectors program like PPP, modality kind of infrastructure project, those kind of things. So I think even with the new bank, as colleagues from China mentioned, about how we work together to address the huge infrastructure deficit, right? So this new bank certainly will complement, right, rather than substitute the existing bank. I'm quite sure that's the kind of relationship we see, right? Our Bangladesh colleagues about how we treat this existing bank and the new bank. So certainly we are the partner, the new bank and existing bank will work together, So that's what I want to say. Sorry about that,
No, thank you very much. And I think in interest of time, I will have to really stop here because of the stress it is causing outside this room. But just to say that this is a subject of tremendous interest to our member states, and we will have follow-up discussion. Luncheon is another platform where we can talk more and you can ask more, have more dedicated discussions. I did want to mention that we have an MOU with Asian Development Bank, and recently there were deliberations with the ADB, and regional connectivity will be an important area for our collaboration also. Besides the fact that we will have more collaboration with other agencies. So with this, I'd like to thank our distinguished panelists who have
undoubtedly added value to this deliberation. But most of all, I'd like to thank all the delegates because you had very good comments and you have given a lot of food for thought to us. And what they say is this session to be continued, hopefully in different form and body in near future. And we will try to summarize the deliberation of this session and provide you further answers to the questions that have been raised by consulting our panelists, and we will put that on our website for your reading. Thank you so much, and a big hand of applause for our panelists and also for our discussion.
Thank you, Executive Secretary, and our distinguished panelists for a thought-provoking and insightful discussion. It goes without saying that the theme of our conference has been very well chosen: regional connectivity for shared prosperity. This is a theme that all of us seem to consider extremely agree that is extremely important, and many of us have articulated our willingness to contribute towards improving regional connectivity. Connectivity for shared transport over land, sea, air, and our rivers. Connectivity for shared knowledge by connecting data and information. Connectivity for shared energy, electrical power, fuel, gas. Connectivity for shared economies, business, trade, capitals, and most importantly, markets. All these connectivities are important, but if we are to reap the rewards of this regional connectivity for greater prosperity, for shared prosperity, we must eventually connect our peoples. Connectivity for shared prosperity through connecting our peoples. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen, we will now break for lunch. May I request you to reconvene here at 12:15, I am told, a quarter past two. You must be hungry, so I must give you time to eat your food. So 2:15, we will convene here. But before we adjourn, I would like to request the Secretary of the Commission, Mr. Aliani, to make some housekeeping announcements. Mr. Aliani.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Excellencies, distinguished delegates, ladies and gentlemen. Lunch of the Executive Secretary would be for heads of delegation would be served on the ground floor. So please, those of you who have received your invitation cards, please proceed to the ground floor for the lunch. The side event on mainstreaming the disaster risk reduction in Asia and the Pacific will be held immediately after lunch in this hall. And as the chair has said, the lunch has been shortened to 45 minutes. So we will resume at 1500 hours. Thank you very much.
A very hungry chair happily adjourns this meeting.